Good evening. Thank you for rejoining us and joining us and being here with us to hear the continuation of the story as told by Tony Hendriks, writer, actor, comedian. But he's also shared with us in last week's program about his sojourn in England, when he went back to England, went through school, left school and got involved in the entertainment industry, and some demons that he had to struggle with. Came back to Jamaica, still had to fight them off, and we were at the point where he'd had this accident, a massive accident on Hope Road. He went home, crashed in every sense of the word, woke up the following morning, and then it was the aha moment. Thank you for joining me. Good evening. This is Profile. I am Faye Ellington. You know, you look at people sometimes, and especially those people who make us laugh, we never know that there are points in their lives when they hurt deeply. And sometimes it's so painful, it's hard to understand, or it's just unfathomable sometimes. So there you are, an addict, you have this massive accident, you woke up the following morning, banged your head against a board wall 20-odd times, and then what?
Well, Albert Einstein says for every action there's an equal and opposite reaction, right? So it was that moment where I realized, you know, I guess if I was a very religious person, it would be being born again. It was a point of light. And it was certainly a point that I realized, for me, I'd been trying to just give up everything. The few times that I had tried to sort myself out, and I couldn't manage it.
Because you were drinking.
I was drinking.
Using weed.
In Jamaica. I was drinking, I was using weed, and I was taking coke as well. And I realized that what I needed to do was I needed to stop the drugs. I needed to stop taking the coke. I actually stopped smoking herb because it was ruining my coke high. So I'd stopped doing that at one point, and then I said to myself, but I'm still going to take a drink. Now, everybody at NA, Narcotics Anonymous, and AA were like, well, I couldn't go to AA because I was drinking. So NA was saying, this is a bad idea because you're going to drink, and you're going to lower your resistance, and you're going to go back on it. It's going to happen. Only you, as the person who is sure that this is your new path, can be convinced. You don't need to convince other people. In fact, you can't convince other people. It took me years for people, they'd look at you. If I stayed up all night going fishing, or I went to, you know, some fest or something like that, and I red eyes in the morning, people look at you and they go, back again. And it wasn't the case. But you can't convince them. There's no screaming and shouting and saying, no, no. You just have to just continue like that.
How difficult was it? Did you have withdrawal symptoms?
Not physical withdrawal symptoms per se. But yeah, I mean, you do, absolutely. One of the things I've found, and I think it's the same when you're jogging, if you're a runner, if you miss a day, you know, it's an addiction. You really want to go back. The converse is also true. You start to go, no, I'm going to do another day, and I know I'm going to be good. And yes, of course, it's hard. You get into the middle of the afternoon, which was when I would start to get into trouble. And I would go, okay, I need to do something. I need to fill that time. I need to find things to do. And at night I would take a drink, and I drank for another 4 years until I realized, okay, now I've been clean for 4 years, I can stop the alcohol. December the 3rd, 1996, who's counting? And I said, all right, I bought a crate of vodka, and I drank it straight until it finished, and which took about a week. And then next morning, I said, that's it, I'm done.
That's it?
And I did.
So you've been clean for how many years? From 96 through now?
No, I've been, 80, no, let's get this right. The 29 years, I've been clean. 25 years, I've been sober. And 23 years, I've been smoke-free.
Wow.
With no cigarettes and everything. And cigarettes was the hardest thing to give up.
Wow.
The toughest thing physically. The withdrawal symptoms, the fact that it's socially accepted if I went and burn a cigarette outside there, nobody's not going to say anything, as opposed to falling down drunk or taking drugs. Cigarettes is the most insidious thing, and it's government approved, if you like, because they take tax from it and stuff. Anyway, moving on.
get on, let's move on with your life.
Absolutely.
And so I met Tony Hendriks after he returned to Jamaica, been doing plays and television and all of that. Just lay it out for me. Radio, TV, videos.
I started working in the theatre. When I came back, the theatre was definitely something that I hadn't been doing, and it's what I left at school but never really followed up with afterwards. So I came here, I said, oh, let me do that. I went and auditioned for Garvey the Musical with Perry Henzel, and I got the part, got several parts, played all the white, not all the white people, because Munir Zaka and Bobby Gassiz and Paul Issa were in it as well.
But you're a typecast.
Let me tell you something, it was the most wonderful experience. We were at the Ward Theatre, and the first part I played was Busha, you know, who was the father of the daughter where Marcus worked and stuff, and I was a buffoon and it was funny and everything, and the crowd laughed and the Ward Theatre packed and laughing, nothing better than that. And then later on down the line, I played the Chief Justice who walks on stage and says, Garvey, you are under arrest. And somebody in the top shout out, why, Busha? Oh, you can't go on so bad. I mean, that's Jamaican theatre, and Jamaican theatre audience is interactive and stuff. And so that was wonderful. Garvey the Musical. Irene Neighbours, actually, that was a great part because that was a part written for Oliver, but he couldn't do it. Myrna Lawton, and she'd written the play with Leonie, I think, and they wanted to put it on. They had the theatre. Oliver wasn't there, so I played the part, Rev, which was written for Oliver. So that was great because that was one of the parts. It wasn't just a white man. It was just me playing it. It was just a part of a Rev, you know. So I did that. I did I, Marcus Garvey. I won awards for that. Pantomime with Oliver. I did pantomime.
The national pantomime. But you did Derek Walcott's pantomime.
Myself and Oliver both won Best Actor.
It was amazing.
That was fun. That was a lot of fun.
You're a brilliant actor, you know.
Well,
that.
That's very sweet of you to say. Yeah. Thank you.
If there were two or three productions that stand out for you, productions done in Jamaica, what would they be?
For me, that I was in, I adored Trevor Roan's Schools Out, where I played Roscoe Callender. Again, that wasn't a part. That was just a part for an actor. So that was great, and it was anarchic, and it was wonderful. And I loved doing that. And Man Talk, where I played a lot of separate characters, including a child molester, a gay guy. So they were a stretch to find those roles and difficult roles for people to watch and stuff. So I thought that those were good. But you know what? You know, I can tell you stories of different things. Children.
Oh, but please, you almost made me lose my reputation. I was in that production.
It was a rebirth.
Opening night, he was baby Jesus being born. It was unbelievable. Little theatre, the actors, when Tony carried on, we were a mess.
But that's part of the fun, certainly in theatre.
That's
as
Aston
well.
Cook and Joan Andrea Hutchinson.
Was, I think, it was Dahlia in that. I think Dahlia might have been in that.
I can't Simon remember. Crosskill. Yeah, Simon was in it.
What's her name? So, Kathy, the newsreader from CVM at the time.
Owen.
She was in it. It was Kathy Owen.
Yeah.
I can't remember.
But
was
that
good.
Was something else.
That was fun.
But
Laugh Jamaica.
Laugh Jamaica, yes. You've done, then you got into writing scripts again, because you'd been doing that before and doing videos and stuff.
Well, what happened was doing the theatre was, there was a lot of times when people would call me up to play Busha or to play Baccarat or to play something that was very sort of typecasting, and I didn't really want to do that. I wanted to do stuff. Also, theatre, although I was lucky for a couple of years of doing nothing but theatre, I wanted to do other things. People were saying, well, you know, you can't tell a joke, you know, why don't you do stand up? And there was stuff, you know.
Just tell me about the classic car occasion.
Right.
Because this is when the stand up may have taken root.
It's where the stand up and the writing came together. I started telling a few jokes at a few places and I realized I could do it and I enjoyed it. But I was telling book jokes, you know, I mean, jokes that you'll tell in the bar and all of that kind of stuff. So nothing original per se. And I think it was Babsy who had asked me to go and perform at the Classic Car Show down at the arena. And I wrote a specific piece for the Classic Car, which was I was announcing I'd had a letter from the government they'd done deals with all the manufacturers around the world to manufacture cars in Jamaica. But with one stipulation, we're going to name the cars after people who are in Jamaican society and the public face. So they would
start with the
Morris Manley. We'd have the Ford Sierra. There would be the Toyota Bartlett. They were going to do one car. It was a Lada. It was going to be called a Lada Samuda, but it kept having trouble because it kept swinging from side to side. You know, of course, there was the Porsche Simpson. and there was going to be one which was for Omar Davis, and they were going to call it the Audi. Audi. Anybody can afford a car in Jamaica? I don't know.
Let us take a break. When we come back, we'll continue our conversation with Tony Hendriks. Brilliant. Absolutely.